Thank you, Anoop, and thank you, Professor Bakshi. I think I'll start with this caveat. I can't profess to be very objective because I have appeared in the matter on the side of the Union of India.
Okay.
Well, first of all, just to get a little overall perspective on the magnitude and importance of judicial appointments in the specific Indian context. The higher judiciary in India plays a very unique role that transcends the traditional role of the courts as adjudicators of disputes, either private disputes between citizens or between citizens and the state. In India, the courts are usually in the news in their activist avatar for taking on often corrupt, often inefficient or apathetic governments, filling in when the executive hasn't performed its task or where the legislature has left a vacuum. And this is, I have to say, been a largely positive role that the judiciary has played. I mean, look at the range of cases that our courts, our higher courts, are called upon to decide, and the Supreme Court in particular, whether it's the coal block allocation case, the 2G licenses which came to be cancelled, black money case in the past, the Hawala case. These are just a few, and then you have, say, the river water disputes, or you have air and water pollution. And then on the other hand, you have cases like 377, on the other end of the spectrum, the transgender case, sexual harassment, etc. But these are just some which show the very, very wide range of issues on which our courts are called to pronounce judgment on. And of course, apart from this, there are other issues, whether yoga should be introduced into the school curriculum, how children should be admitted to primary schools, or whether Sardar jokes should be banned or not, or whether, how to tackle the monkey menace in Delhi. So these are, there's hardly a facet of life which remains untouched by orders of the higher courts in India. And as I said, that although the courts have played a largely positive role, the fact remains that the impact of these orders is very, very far-reaching. So you may have, thousands, maybe millions of people who are not even before the court, who haven't been heard before the court, and their lives, their livelihoods do get impacted by certain judgments, generally in the PIL jurisdiction. So a single order may not just affect lives, livelihoods, it may impact the economy, may impact international obligations, may make people liable in international fora to pay damages and so on, as has happened, for example, in the 2G case. And this really makes our higher judiciary, the role it plays in the lives of people, really quite unparalleled and unique. And I dare say that the Supreme Court of India is perhaps the most powerful court in the world. I mean, if you look at one, of course, the range and importance of issues that it decides, and coupled with the sheer numbers that are involved, because in India we are, a population of 1.3 billion, which effectively means 1/6, I think, of the human race. So if you, the issues coupled with the numbers of people, the number of people who are impacted by these decisions, India is really quite different. Also, we are a growing economy. We are a very ambitious economy. We are aggressively seeking investment from different parts of the world. And if we are to instill confidence in investors, then we've got to have a system which provides an efficient justice delivery. And therefore, I would say that the judicial system is an equal and crucial partner even in our economic growth. And no matter how much investment we may attract from overseas, unless we are able to instill in investors the confidence that if things go wrong, they won't be stuck in courts for years on end, it's just no good. And so just as the government, just as parliament needs to sort of shed sort of that image of inefficiency, or so does the judiciary. And it is in this context, I think, that we've got to examine the importance of judicial appointments. What kind of people should make judges? What are the eligibility criteria? Should these be publicly declared criteria? Are good lawyers good enough to be good judges, or do we need something more? Do we need to examine, say, the social outlook of a judge, his or her social sensitivity, his sense of or her sense of life outside of the law? And who should have a say in this process? How accountable should this process be? Is it enough if judges have the only say in appointments, or should it be judges and the executive? Or do you need a check on both these organs, and do we need civil society represented? Are there more stakeholders then? And therefore, should the appointing authority be a more broad-based authority? The other question is, of course, whether the judiciary should reflect social diversity. And is this possible to achieve without compromising merit? And is a diverse judiciary that draws from different sections of society, whether women, whether other marginalized sections, is it more likely to inspire public confidence? I mean, to give you just one example, for example, in South Africa, if you were to have only white male judges, it's possible that a black woman would feel that she may not get a justice in court. So therefore, do we need that social diversity, and can we achieve it without compromising on merit? These are some of the questions which really arise when we speak of judicial appointments, and whether the NJAC really sought to achieve that. Now, there was already one given in the case, I think, that independence of the judiciary is a non-negotiable value. I think on both sides, everybody was very clear about this. The question was whether the NJAC is a system or was a system which achieved judicial appointments while not compromising judicial independence. Now, the issue of basic structure. Now, basic structure represents, because ultimately it's the amendment which had to be tested on the touchstone of the basic structure. Now, so many things were said about the basic structure, but really the basic structure is something which represents the very, very foundational, fundamental values which form the core of the Constitution. And these are really the foundational pillars which prop up the system. So if you were to remove one of those pillars, your whole system would come crashing down, and you'd be left with a country you do not recognize. So some of these foundational values, for example, they were mentioned, the rule of law, for example, or of which judicial independence is an integral part, or you have the freedom of speech, or the freedom of religion, free and fair elections, democracy, so on and so forth. So these are those foundational pillars on which our system rests. And the basic structure is therefore in the pillars themselves, not in the nuts and bolts which hold them up. Because if you were to replace those nuts and bolts which might have grown old with newer ones, with stronger ones, perhaps more modern ones, would it automatically, can it mean that the basic structure has collapsed? Or is it firmer, stronger basic structure? So therefore, the question is whether the nitty-gritties, whether the method of appointment was one so as to damage the basic structure, and were those foundational pillars, were they going to come crashing down merely because you changed that method of appointment? Now, as far as the petitioners in this case was concerned, their Bible really was the second judge's case, which according to them provided that, or laid down that the last word really rests with the judiciary in matters of judicial appointment. That is primacy. Of course, primacy has been interpreted to mean many things, but I would call it the last word, and that's the way they put it too. So, i.e., is it the collegium that has the last word in matters of judicial appointment? Now, it's interesting that two of the judgments, one is a minority judgment of Justice Chalmeshwar and the other of Justice Madan Lokur, I found that in at least two places, they say that the executive had proceeded on a complete misunderstanding of the judgment, and which is to say that actually Justice Chalmeshwar said that consultation did not mean concurrence, and Justice Lokur says that at least two places that in matters, in certain matters, it is the president, that is the executive, who had the final say, and in other matters, it is the judiciary who has the final say. Now, in fact, he makes reference to a speech from, an article by Justice Verma, much later, of course, when Justice Verma seeks to explain his judgment and say how it had been misunderstood. And this is what he says. I'll read this short passage. The clear language of the decision leaves no room for any doubt that the executive has a participatory role in these appointments. The opinion of the executive is weightier in the area of antecedents and personal character and conduct of the candidate. The power of non-appointment on this ground is expressly with the executive, notwithstanding the recommendation of the CJI, and that doubtful antecedents are alone sufficient for non-appointment by the executive. The decision also holds that the opinion of the judicial collegium, if not unanimous, does not bind the executive to make the appointment, unquote. I think it's quite clear here. And the question is, can this be interpreted to mean that the judiciary had the last word at all times? I do not think it means that. But even assuming that the judiciary had the final word, was that primacy absent in the NJSC? Given that, and consider this, one, the fact that 3 out of 6 on the NJSC were judicial members, and this is not just 3:3, but it was 3:2:1, two being the two eminent members, and one being the law minister. So it was 3:2:1, number one. Two, the CJI as the chairperson had the prerogative of calling meetings. 3, the CJI had a say in the nomination of and selection of the two eminent persons being part of the committee of 3. 4, the two judges, any two judges on the NJSC could have outvoted an undesirable candidate. And therefore, you know, it's very difficult to say that the judges did not have primacy even under the NJSC. One of the strong factors which weighed in the minds of the majority was the fact, the veto power. And I'm going to just discuss this for a bit, because the veto that the even eminent persons who might have had no qualifications in the law were, you know, empowered to use against the judges to effectively outvote or knock out a candidate whom the judges might have proposed. But one thing to remember is that the veto wasn't actually in the act. It was in the act. It wasn't in the amendment. And therefore, to strike down the amendment on this ground was, I think, you know, not necessary at all. It was, in fact, it ought not to have been tested on that ground. The act could have always been read down. It could have even been struck down. But that would have still left the amendment intact. Now, another ground for striking down the amendment was that the position of the CJI had been diluted. Now, this is interesting because I don't think it was the NJSC which diluted the position of the CJI, but the second judge's case, which completely diluted the individual voice of the CJI. Because what it said was that the collegium at that time comprising of three would have to have speak with a unanimous voice, and only then would the president be bound to accept that recommendation. Now, dilution in the second judge's case of the individual voice of the CJI was further diluted in the third judge's case when the collegium was expanded to a strength of five. So therefore, I think this may not be quite a correct reading of the NJSC. Now, next is the presence of the law minister. I have a couple of other points. Is that all right? Yeah. The presence of the law minister. Now, it was, you know, the second judge's case said this, and even the fourth judge's case says so, that the executive is bound to provide all the background information on a candidate, and that is required to be put before the judges so that they can take an informed decision on the antecedents and the personal whatever traits, etc., of a particular candidate. Now, this information had to be furnished to the judges. Now, the problem was that here under the NJSC, you would have the law minister sitting in front of, right, you know, face to face with the rest of the, you know, the judicial members. And this information would be shared up front. So was this so egregious? This and the fact is that the law minister was only one out of six. He wouldn't have had a veto. And therefore, was this so abhorrent that it violated the basic structure? Now, the role of eminent persons, again, has been, it was argued at great length. And, in fact, there was some counsel even on the side of the respondents who felt that, you know, you can't have just eminent persons. They've got to be connected with the law. They've got to have a legal background. They've got to be jurists, etc. But I think, personally, I think that was very counterproductive, because ultimately when you have a commission of six, you do not want everybody to be bringing the same input on the table. You want to have, you know, everybody shouldn't be only making a contribution to the legal or the judicial competencies of the particular candidate. You want different perspectives. So the eminent persons perhaps would have been able to bring one and more objective perspective, and two, the, you know, what kind of, you know, social outlook, what kind of philosophy, what is the general awareness of this candidate, what is his general sense of life outside of the law, because, you know, this wide range of functions and roles which the courts are required to play. So, besides, one of those members was required to belong to the SCST or be a woman candidate. Now, that is not just symbolism, because it would send a strong message that we want a more diverse judiciary. There is this tendency, in fact, there are studies on it in Australia, on judicial cloning, the tendency to want to clone, and this is a perfectly bona fide, the best of judges have this tendency, and there, as I said, there are studies on this, of homosocial reproduction. A judge wants to replicate himself, his philosophy, his, the same kind of background, the same social background, educational background. He wants to see someone in his own image when he is appointing someone else. So that tendency was required to be sort of, kept in check by this presence of the eminent persons. And of course, the eminent persons would have been, you know, free of the pulls and pressures, the objective, and they would have most importantly kept a check on, or rather just be a cozy club of lawyers, or, you know, on the judges as well as the executive. So therefore, it was intended to bring in this breath of fresh air, but, you know, now, of course, that's a thing of the past. I think, you know, there are a few other points, but I think only I will, yeah, later. Thank you.
Mr. Ramchandran suggested that I make my points now so as to continue maintaining the balance. I'll quickly run through some points and so that we can stay on schedule and Mr. Ramchandran can have his time. What has struck me particularly about the debate has been this entire discussion as though judicial review is undemocratic, that this entire idea that judges can strike down constitutional amendments or legislations, there seems to be a general discussion that that's somehow undemocratic. And I think that largely misunderstands the democratic argument. What parliaments do, what legislative bodies do, is a certain conception of democracy. It's a very procedural conception of democracy. And what judicial review does, and what is sought to be achieved by courts reviewing legislations, is more substantive in nature. So these are two very, and I think there are two very different conceptions of democracy at play. And I don't think there's a need to obfuscate that somehow procedural democracy is somehow more legitimate than what the idea of democracy being pursued with judicial review. Right? Another interesting argument that came up and has been addressed in the various opinions, and I think that's, and I'd like to hear from Ms. Devan on it later, in terms of whether basic structure is to be read as per what judgments have developed the text to be, the meaning given to the text, or is basic structure limited to the original text, right? That while deciding in the context of 124, that whether it is basic structure or not, the argument seems to have been that we should not be bound by the meaning given to the word consultation, right? And rather, it is open to the court to go back to the origin, to the sort of literal meaning of the text, and not be bound by the judicial meaning given to it in previous judgments. And I think that's a very problematic road to go down on, to say that, and it takes us down a path of, in some sense, a sort of originalism argument, I think, that is best avoided. And I think the experience of the US Supreme Court speaks to that. And I think it's in that context also, if you see the massive importance given to the Constituent Assembly debates, and the concern, and I sort of have a concern with that in terms of the courts really haven't developed any sort of a coherent discourse on how Constituent Assembly debates are to be invoked, what weight they are to be given, and what kind of persuasive value does it have. There's a lot of haziness around that, and I think this judgment brings that problem to the fore, that this, in combination with this basic structure argument in terms of original text and this repeated invocation and very forceful invocation, that somehow we have to adhere to what was said in the CADs, and somehow that we can decipher one singular meaning or one singular intention from the Constituent Assembly debates, I think is quite problematic. In terms of the amendment versus law question, I think Justice Lokur picks up on something, and I think is quite relevant, saying if you look at 217, and which is the position of the Chief Justice and the consultation of the Chief Justice of the High Court, right? And I think very little discussion has happened around that. How the NJAC has just completely obliterated that, right? There's just no role for the Chief Justice of the High Court in the NJAC proposed model, and that's a problem with the amendment, and not with the veto of the provided for in the legislation, right? And I think another problem with the amendment is, and I agree with the argument that 124 gives pride of place to consultation with the Chief Justice, right? Whatever the meaning might have been developed around this, might have been developed around consultation with the Chief Justice, just on its very reading, 124 says, gives pride of place to consultation with the Chief Justice, and that certainly is taken away by the amendment, by making the Chief Justice one of six people, right? Yes, everybody is equal powers, but I certainly think it's a dilution of the pride of place given within 124, and as I said, the problematic complete removal of the role for the High Court Chief Justice in 217 in the amendment. And I think fundamentally it was only this: once the review was not allowed, once the review was not allowed of the second judge's case. I don't think the court had any other, in that sense, I don't think there's any other outcome that was possible. The only way to get around the primacy argument, and we can discuss whether primacy is a basic structure or whether primacy is the only way to ensure judicial independence, we can debate all of that. But as long as the second judge's case stands, and this case was being heard before a five judges bench, and this bench did not allow the review of the second judge's case, I think you have to go with the meaning that the meaning given to the word consultation in 124, and you can't just, and I don't think the argument that we can take away the basis of the judgment by removing the word consultation holds water in that context, because I think you're bound by what the second judges said. I'll stop here, and I'll come back with some more questions once Mr. Ramchandran has had the chance to make his remarks.